In this episode, I'm joined by Hans Gerding, who is a professor of philosophy at Leiden University and of parapsychology at Utrecht University. In this episode, we discuss Kant, Schopenhauer, philosophical counselling, and parapsychological experiences. I'd like to thank all my paid subscribers and patrons for making all of this work possible, and if you'd like to support a Mythics podcast or become part of the community, please find links in the description below. Enjoy. So, Hans Gerding, thanks very much for joining us on Hermetics Podcast.
Yeah, it's nice to be a guest. Thank you.
So, before we jump in, I mean, we're going to be talking about, in part, philosophical counselling, philosophy in terms of paranormal and exceptional experiences, which are often ignored. But before we jump in on these sort of wide array of topics that we're going to be discussing, just tell us a little bit about you and what it is you do.
Well, to put it short, When I was a philosophy student, I started my study. I didn't know anything about philosophy. And it was in the 60s, 70s in Amsterdam. I took LSD. I had a mystical experience. And then as a beginning philosophy student, I thought, well, this is philosophy. And this will be my way through philosophy. So... then I studied as much as I can philosophers that I liked, and I also, after a few years, came in contact with the field of parapsychology. I found it very surprising that there was a professor doing experiments with exceptional experiences. So I studied parapsychology as well, and after my studies, I wrote a PhD on Kant and the paranormal, and I started working in the Institute for Parapsychology in Utrecht. And later on in my life, I got an appointment in Leiden University in the philosophy department. So my work is, my fascination is exceptional experiences, and I approach them from the field of philosophy, from science, the science of parapsychology, and also I try as much as I can to experience these myself by meditation and studying my dreams and so on.
Do you mind if I ask what the LSD experience was of? What was the mystical experience you had?
Well, it was, there were some moments in which flashes of light told me that they are the true reality, that everything is made of living light, and that I myself also was living light. And I was so taken by this experience because I was 22, and nobody ever told me things like this. While experiencing this, it was also a bit of coming home, as a sort of recognition, which I later on I learned from near-death experiences. They have the same experience, and they also say, finally, I'm at home. And I contact with something which is an ultimate reality of everything.
So did you straight away make a connection between the flashes of light and some philosophy you read about, or was that the sort of the real starting point for you in terms of exploring philosophy?
Yeah, it was a starting point. It was a kind of magnetic needle. Mm-hmm. I thought I have to follow this magnetic needle pointing at these philosophers and ideas that have something to do with this experience.
Okay.
So I came for instance, Schopenhauer and also Carl Jung.
Mm-hmm.
Became very important man for me.
Okay. That leads me to the hermetics question then. If you could place three thinkers, living or dead, into a room and listen in on the conversation, who would you pick?
Well, I would pick Schopenhauer, Carl Jung, and an imaginary figure. if that is allowed, representing what you can call transpersonal psychology, because it includes spirituality and also parapsychological research.
So the imaginary figure is just something that represents transpersonal psychology.
Yeah.
It isn't. It isn't. In what sense is it an imaginary figure then? It doesn't have a body or a personality.
No, but they can this figure can take the shape of some of my heroes, men like Charlie Tart or Stanley Krippner or Stanislav Grof, or also some older the anti-psychiatry, the men like Ronald Lane and so on.
So what's the conversation that you'd like to have with these people, with you know, Schopenhauer, and these transpersonal psychologists?
Well, what I like about them is I like to talk about them is what they can teach me. So a conversation should have in its center things like mysticism, spirituality, also the whole variety of exceptional experiences, and the context in which they should be interpreted, things like that.
And so why do you think it is then that these experiences, which it seems to have been the focus of your work, these external experiences, paranormal experiences, why do you think these are sort of ignored or seen as sort of a wrong way to do things in philosophy?
That asks for an answer in more stages. First, the historical point is interesting. Historical point is that in the Middle Ages, mysticism is dangerous for many people. Hey? You get burned or something and things like that. But when about 400 years ago, science took over from religion, the Institute of Religion, they had the same attitude towards these experiences. That didn't change. I would say what makes people a bit afraid of these phenomena is that they for modern people is that they are too revealing, so to say. They are too revealing. If you take them serious, you have to accept, for instance, that the human psyche is not a fenced off domain. And when you come to things like that, you immediately are driven to very intriguing, to my idea, very intriguing and fascinating philosophical questions. For instance, when I was reading Jung talking about the unconscious, that is typical Jung, he can just in a few lines write something very intriguing and then leave it and go to another subject. But some of these lines were this. Jung said that if you take the hypothesis of the unconscious seriously, that has enormous epistemological implications, because we are not conscious of everything. There is unconscious, and we even do not know where the borders of our unconscious lie. So the epistemological implications of the unconscious are that all our knowledge is incomplete, and incomplete to a degree we cannot even grasp. So, and he left it there. But it was, I was very excited about that. And nobody, I did. I had lectures, heard lectures, and read books about the philosophy of science. Nobody talks like this, but it is real.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So these questions of these phenomena are not taken seriously. People are hesitant to accept them because they are afraid in the field of science we have the science that make the difference, the very bright men and women, but there is below there is science seen as sociologically as a group you can maybe call the knowledge elite, and this knowledge elite writing serious and taking these phenomena and the research at this phenomena seriously is the same as career suicide. If you are a psychologist and you write a textbook, psychology textbook, and you take a well-balanced chapter on parapsychology in your book, you are sure that it will not be chosen as a textbook for the students. Because one of the main reasons is that these phenomena are too revealing, and they reveal some things about the human psyche that people are afraid of. They are afraid of being thrown back in the Middle Ages in irrationality. While to my idea, it is very very well possible to do very sound and clean research in this field that has been done by many people.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It's interesting there that you use the word phenomena. Do you think that there is with these experiences they are simply phenomena in the Kantian sense for the subject, or do you think there is a potential connection to the thing in itself there? To something completely outside of our perception.
Yes, there are more approaches to this. The first, more most basic approach, is the approach that is can be found in parapsychology.
Mm-hmm.
There you see that in sound experiences, scientifically good designed experiences, in controlled circumstances in laboratories, people conduct paranormal experiments, and they have results. I find it very astonishing that unless all these circumstances, scientific circumstances, nonetheless, these phenomena expose themselves in a way that can be that you can read about in a meta-analysis. It's good to say this. I think today this is mainstream science. In the last 10 years, there is a lot of movement in this field, and 2 years ago, in a peer-reviewed journal, psychology journal in the United States, there was a publication of all meta-analysis in parapsychology that were all statistically significant. And so this is, today it is just mainstream knowledge, only nobody, not many people know this. But, so this is the first step. These phenomena are, scientifically real phenomena. But now comes a very difficult point. You mentioned Kant and the Ding an sich. And I like to add also Schopenhauer, who was in many parts also a Kantian thinker. And to Schopenhauer, these phenomena are only possible if you take his philosophy serious. And the title of his book, The World as Will and Representation, there we see that the world falls into, let's say, two sides. It's the world as will and the world as representation. The world as representation, that is the phenomenological world in which we live, in which we share our experiences. This world is, well, it's unfolds in a Kantian way. There he takes Kant serious, and he said Kant did his work very, very good. He was admired Kant very much. But there's only one thing, Schopenhauer said, to Kant, the ding an sich, the thing in itself that touches our a priori framework, which together with the ding an sich that touches our senses lets the experiential world unfold itself, and we all have do this at the same way, so we all live in the same world. But to Kant this means that the ding an sich, the thing in itself outside us perceiving people, the thing in itself cannot be known at all. But Schopenhauer said, Kant was right in many things, but not that the thing in itself cannot be known. The thing in itself is what I call, Schopenhauer says, what I call will. And that can be known. So apart from being a subject living in a world of phenomena, which is structured in a Kantian way, so time, space and causality reign this world totally, deterministically, at the same time, in the Schopenhauer way of thinking, a subject can turn, as it were, as so to say, he or she can turn, and turn his or her back to the world of phenomena, and, well, see the world of the will. And that here Schopenhauer makes a distinction between looking at something, which we do in the world of representations, the world of phenomena, but being turned to the world of the will, we do not look at it, but we see. So what unfolds then is something which can be divided in many stages also, but first of all, what unfolds is that the process of seeing turns your back to the world of representations. The world of seeing unfolds a dimension of Platonic ideas. So the basic idea of Schopenhauer is there is a will, an omnipresent will, which pours out in matter in the world of representations, and everything that exists is objectified will. And, well, using a metaphor, on its way to manifestation in the world of representations, the will passes Platonic ideas. And there is determined what kind of aspect of the creation this will be. So everything we see, birds, trees, other planets, everything, human beings, of course, is objectified will, but turned to the back to the representations, we see a world of Platonic ideas, and that is a process of seeing. And here art comes in, aesthetics. The aesthetic experience is, in the eyes of Schopenhauer, an experience that is cognitive. It is not just being pleased by something beautiful. No, it is cognitive of a higher order than the world of science, physics, science, just describes the physical phenomena, but a turned mind, seeing Platonic ideas experience as the aesthetic, is an aesthetic experience, and that experience is cognitive, and also I like that this word that Schopenhauer used, the position of consciousness from which this is experienced, he calls this the better consciousness. It's better consciousness. So that makes Schopenhauer, of course, very popular among in the world of art. Also here lies the world of the paranormal, because it is possible to go, as it were, in the world of the will and go back in the world of the phenomena at another place, at another time. And when this happened, people, for instance, report precognitive dreams. So to come back to your question, we can elaborate more on this, but first go back to your question. The answer is yes. These paranormal phenomena need, in the Schopenhauer philosophy, need the world of the will. And so the world of what Kant calls the thing in itself, but Schopenhauer calls it will. So, and these phenomena need this dimension of the will, and therefore Schopenhauer, he is very pleased when he comes to this point, because he didn't know about it, but later on in his life he sees that these paranormal phenomena can only be explained if you take his philosophy seriously. So he says there are three things. We have the world of physics describing the world of representations. We have the world of the paranormal, which I like this word. He calls it practical philosophy, or you can call it empirical philosophy. So these two, physics and empirical philosophy, both are needed to know the world. And then he says, and my philosophy is theoretical metaphysics, not practical metaphysics, but theoretical metaphysics, describing this whole world.
Yeah. So what did Schopenhauer make of these things then? Because obviously Schopenhauer is quite famous for being one of the sort of the early popular atheists. And this is sort of apparent in his biography and in his work. But how does he fit the paranormal worldview in with an atheist worldview? What does he think these things actually are that we're experiencing?
Well, to start with the end, the ultimate cannot be said. But Schopenhauer is one of the first Western thinkers who took Hinduism and Buddhism seriously. And he may be called an atheist, but a very big but comes here, because he teaches a philosophy of freedom. And this freedom is not to be found in the world of phenomena, but while being alive in a world of phenomena, representations, again, we can turn our back to this world, and as I said before, we first experience Platonic ideas. The aesthetic experience makes people free, because the subject of experiences also unfolds. Also, the boundaries of the experiencing ego are more loose, and this looseness can expand and expand and expand as while we go further away from this world of representations. So it also expresses, this process of expanding also expresses itself in the world of ethics. Empathy is possible in this way. Because floating in the world of the will, knowing that everything else also is will, so you are identified with everything else, and that makes empathy possible, and not empathy as an idea or as something you learn from your parents or from a book, but it is experiential. It is a kind of sensitivity that expresses itself again also in the paranormal, because in the paranormal we come to this tool. There is a footnote here by this an old German concept of telepathy is from a German psychiatrist, Markinowski, who lived in the 20s in the 20th century. And he spoke about Persönlichkeitserweiterung um das Du, which means the widening of your personality because of the Thou, because of the other. So, and for instance, in crisis telepathy, when you are asleep, you can have a dream in which you see, for instance, a loved one dying in an accident. And I'll come back to this later, maybe, but this is an act of empathy. And so when it turns out that this accident really happened and so on and so on, it is an act of empathy. So here demonstrates again, the paranormal demonstrates Schopenhauer's philosophy.
And just moving into something that I'm really interested in, sort of, this is something I wasn't actually fully aware of, quite strangely considering my education, but philosophical counselling is one of the other things that we were going to talk about. And I, as my understanding is, you are a philosophical counsellor. And this isn't something I was, as I say, too aware of. And in this, in philosophical counselling, you deal with these kinds of experiences and talk about them philosophically. So it's like an alternative form of, could we say, therapy, which isn't targeted towards health, but is targeted towards exploration of one's life. Do these experiences, is this sort of the primary reason people would come to philosophical counselling, is to have these experiences perhaps explained or find a way to understand what they are?
Well, yes, but I come to this in a second phase. I want to say something else, that philosophical counseling is not new. Everybody knows Socrates was talking about philosophy on the marketplace of Athens, and Aristotle was the mentor of Alexander the Great, and so on. Philosophers play an important role in higher and lower circles. And it was reinvented by a German in the 80s of last century. But this new movement in the 80s of philosophical counseling, it spread it very quickly, because there were many philosophers without a job, and many philosophers, they thought, hey, maybe this is a good and a very nice and way to make a living and to explore philosophy in an interesting way. But the normal way of philosophical counseling has not much to do with exceptional experiences. It can be, everything can be put on the table, of course, but there are many questions, existential questions, meaning, questions of meaning, questions of, but also other questions, relations, also business people who want to have a sparring partner in their thinking process, whether they should buy the company of their competitor and so on. But for me, I was already doing this kind of philosophical practical philosophy because many people came to me when they heard that I'm a philosopher with also doing parapsychological research. Many people came to me and wanted to talk about their experiences. So when this Achenbach came through and philosophical praxis, practical philosophy was spread around Europe very quickly, I jumped in and I thought, well, I am also doing philosophical praxis, but I'm only concentrating on the subject of exceptional experiences. So that is where I work. And this way of counseling bridges a giant gap in society. Because on the one hand, 50% of the people in Western countries report to have had exceptional experience themselves, one or kind of the other, on the one hand. And on the other hand, psychologists, they are not educated in a way that they learn something about these experiences. So there's a big gap. And so that's one. And two is the position of consciousness from which I work is what I call myself a spiritual philosopher. So for me, these experiences, and that is how they present themselves, I would say, is that these experiences point in many cases at a process of unfolding spirituality. So people in my counseling practice, when they come, they often report. It's the first thing I do. I make we go through all the different kind of experiences they have. So there are the process in which people are there. They have all kinds of different exceptional experiences. For instance, they feel they are have out of the body experiences. They have precognitive dreams. They have telepathic impressions, and they don't understand it. They have lucid dreams also, and they do not understand it. And then when you ask about their physical condition, for instance, then it turns out that they also report very subtle fleeing of energy through their body, which they did not have before. And then I can say, well, all these experiences, they belong together. They are described very well in, for instance, Eastern philosophy, but also in Western books about transpersonal psychology, and they point at well, I tell it in other words, but this is the core, of course, what I say now. They point at an unfolding process which aims at something. which is aiming at widening your mental horizon in many ways. One of the most important ways is making you more sensitive. And they agree and they recognize all kinds of these kinds of things. And then it is very comforting, of course, to say that they are not getting crazy, that they have to trust the process, that they that there are many, many people who are in the same process, and that it is good to next to the in front, the primary is of course the experiences and the process, but and in a second stage, it's also interesting and important to read about it in the traditions of wisdom or certain philosophers or certain books from authors or non-fiction books. And that is more or less the core of what my practice is about. And I can maybe I can give an example. There was a woman who had been through such a process and had become very, very sensitive. And one day she had an experience of what I said earlier, of a crisis telepathy, in which she saw a very dear friend dying. And a few days later, she found out that he died exactly in the way she had dreamed. And then she felt guilty. So being such a sensitive person and then feeling guilty is a terrible process to go through. And for years, she was in a severe depression. And we were talking about this, and she had the idea that she was guilty of this death, because she knew, she had seen what afterwards happened. So she had to prevent this accident. That's what she's telling herself. And that made her her depression. So I told her, you can also look at it from another side. You can also look at it from the point that maybe his time had come. Maybe it was his time to die. And then we talked about dying and how difficult this for us to imagine. We only can imagine, of course, but how difficult this process must be. Leaving behind your loved ones, the earth, everything beautiful you have met in this life, leaving all this behind and facing death and facing what will happen to you. It's very lonely and frightful and frightening and difficult moment. And then I said to her, I think that by participating in his life, in a Schopenhauerian way, so to say, being part of his experiential life and standing next to him in this accident, that is an act of empathy. And that is, I think that your friend, conscious or unconscious, noticed your presence in his moment of dying. And so you supported him, you helped him in this difficult moment. And well, then it was just one counseling. This was what just one talk we had. But she, her face was bright, and her depression was gone. After a few weeks, I met her, and after 2 years, I met her again, and it was gone. And she could live very well with this interpretation of her experience.
So, Is that sort of the goal of philosophical counselling, is to understand these ongoings in a way which is sort of potentially in concordance with what's going on in one's life, or can they be something completely other?
You mean
so this telepathic experience was very personal to her, you found. Yeah. But is there other cases or experiences where they're not really related to the personal life, and they are just something completely alien, completely strange?
Do you mean for instance abduction experiences?
It could be those. I mean something which isn't a paranormal experience which doesn't have a connection to their personal life, so it's just completely disconnected, but is a strange experience, so it can't be counseled in the same way. It has to be understood in a different way. So with the telepathic experience, that still seems quite human, in that it's connected to her personal life and her personal relationships. Are there, other experiences, other ongoings which can happen to someone which don't have these relations, which are just completely disconnected from, they can't be understood in the usual way?
Yeah, but then you come more in the field of a mysticism, for instance.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And there, the first thing we have to say, which you can read in many books, people who know about it don't talk about it, and people who talk about it, so obviously don't know about it. So the ultimate cannot be said here, but mm-hmm. people, nonetheless, it is possible to talk a bit about this. First, the first thing to do is start talking about spirituality in general. I find it very useful to use Jung's concept of individuation. And individuation is a process which unfolds in the life of the individual, by which he is freeing him or herself from unconscious traumas, and then taking the open sea, as it so to say. And where this leads, that unfolds in a different way for different people. But no, as I said, nonetheless, it is possible talking about this. I like this metaphor. When you compare it to something else, when you compare it to the mixing of colors, and when you mix colors, the primary colors, then you get white. And so in the same way as you can mix colors, if you do it in the right way, with light, it can then in the right way, then you get white light. In the same way, your system is not mixing colors, but is mixing faculties. It is mixing thinking, intuition, feeling, perception. And if you mix this in the right way, you get white, living white light, and which goes along with the experience that is the ultimate what you are, and that is what is unfolding, and what is also has many sides, because it is an overwhelming experience, but it is also directing your life. It points at, well, yeah, to say it a bit strong, it points at real freedom. And this subject of freedom is important in philosophy, of course. And freedom is not meant here as having the possibility to choose between many things, but from this perspective, there are not many things. There is only one thing. Just go for this process. with all what you have. And freedom means that you consciously make the decision to go for this process. And that is, well, it's a bit paradoxically formulated, but you can say it is a binding freedom. It binds you at this experience, and you do not want to walk on another way or other road. So philosophical counseling is as I experienced in my practice, is supporting the yeah, well, what I think is the ultimate goal in people's lives. It is in the end, in near-death experiences, people literally experience this also, and they in many cases they have not so much problems that they need assistance of a philosopher or a psychiatrist, but they can do it themselves. But well, some people they get insecure, or they don't have in their neighborhood or their partner people who understand a bit of these things. And then in a philosophical counseling practice, you can learn about a bit of these experiences.
It's interesting that you mentioned near-death experiences. Do you think that our modern relationship with death and suffering is sort of fairly damaging to our understanding of the world?
Yeah, I think. Well, today it is popular, again, within circles of the knowledge elite, it is popular to be atheist and to think there is no survival. At best, people say I'm agnostic. Well, it is interesting that Kant says in his book about Swedenborg, he says it very nice way, I think. He said, "This survival and being living after your death as a ghost, that is," he said, "that is not a known impossibility. It is not a known impossibility." But today there is again is this gap. So many people believe in an afterlife. The knowledge elite does not, and at best says they are agnostic. But now it comes. To me, I would say this form of agnosticism is pseudo-agnosticism, because they did not seriously do their work. If you are take an agnostic standpoint, then you you should study the important fields for this, and that is you should know about the phenomenology of the dying experience. You should read about near death experiences. You should study the phenomenon of dissociation and trance. And you, of course, you should study the field of parapsychology. So there are to the survival question. There are, you have to know about these fields, and then you make your decision, and then after you did all this study, you can say, nonetheless, I stay in an agnostic standpoint, or some other people say, I'm convinced. The whole point of survival, you can say two important points. That is, one point is very clear, formulated by Carl Jung when he was interviewed 2 years before he died. He was asked, Mr. Jung, you say that death is so important in life. But why? Because that is an end. We all know that's an end. And then Jung says, well, if that is an end, you are right. But we are not completely sure about that. And then he continues, and then he takes par psychology. He said, we know, and only, well, ignorant people deny this, but we know that the human psyche is able to look around corners and to in a paranormal way, and to foresee the future in a paranormal way. So obviously, there is something with the human psyche which is not within the framework of time and space. And our body is dying in time and space. There's something is left, and that goes on. So that is the point of view from the science of parapsychology. And then I think that what people with near-death experiences report, underlined with other kinds of experience like out-of-body experiences, that I would say that points at the idea of what can be called an embodied form of survival. So, an astral embodied form of survival. That is what the phenomenology points at in a very convincing way, I would say. And so these ideas should be more central in the education of therapists and people working in medicine, and because it obviously it changes our view about death. Death being a door, transformation process.
So which phenomenology do you think specifically Kant and Schopenhauer, or is there other phenomenology that points to this continuation of an astral body after death?
Well, I would say that what's pointed at an astral form of survival of post-mortal existence is the many reports of people, the experienced people report. They are very, very convincing, and you cannot, of course, do experiments with this, but people report astral traveling, and they appear at other places. They use, obviously, then latent functions, and here I like to refer to Carlos Castaneda. He is an American anthropology student who get teachings from a Mexican sorcerer. And one thing about these books of Castaneda, I find them very interesting, also for philosophers. What can be done in this? Can be done, but the teacher, the source teaches Castaneda, is that you can move your assembly point. You can move your assembly point. It lies on your back, physiologically, in a subtle energetic field, and this assembly point, that is the position of consciousness from which the world is assembled in a Kantian way, the normal world. And so here Kant comes in, but Kant has only one assembly point. But in shamanism, and this sorcerer is able to replace, to shift Castaneda's assembly point, from which he has a totally different perception of the world. He sees the world, for instance, in beams of light. And these beams of light, they can conduct his astral body to different places. And here seems to be a bit of a known way of manipulating these paranormal latent forces. And here we come, I'd like to add something else what I find very interesting. There is a psychiatry professor, Harvard psychiatry professor, John Mack, and he is just a normal worldview, as a normal psychiatrist. But he came across all those kind of experiences of abduction, and he said, "Well, I don't believe this, but so many people report these experiences." So then he went to his friend Thomas Kuhn, the famous philosopher of science. They were mates from the same school and so on. He knew him very well. And he asked Kuhn, "What should I do with these reported experiences?" And then Kuhn said something very, very interesting, which helped me a lot. He said, "Well, John, when it comes to things like religion and spirituality, you must take a totally different position of consciousness. You must not use the normal dual concepts of exists not, is subjective or objective. It is internal or external, or it happened or happened not. It is something between." And the interesting point is that this something between, which is more associated with a Schopenhauerian will, this position in between, and the circle is closed, but we come back to the things we talked about in the beginning. It is this something in between is not a fantastic world. It is not fantasy, but it has a real underlining in real paranormal phenomena, which can be demonstrated. So it is a part of a not pure subjective world, and that, well, then you can, yeah, then it seems to be another dimension. So this I think that a man like Castaneda makes this very interesting by having the possibility of the assembly point being shift to another place on his back. It is light that lies on his back, yeah.
Okay. Is there anything you would like to add, or something that we've missed that you'd like to add in?
Well, an end is what my philosopher professor, where I did my PhD, wrote about, and that is that's this point. He says that 400 years ago, our whole society landed in what he called a rational empirical position of consciousness. And this position of consciousness became dominant in our society. Mm-hmm. And this position of consciousness also is endlessly tolerant, because it can be directed at everything. You can formulate any question, and always you can approach this question from a rational empirical position of consciousness. Nonetheless, there is an intolerance. And this intolerance does not lie at the object side, because you can approach everything from this position of consciousness. It lies within, in the subject side. It is in the subject side where we identified ourselves with this position of consciousness and making it impossible to take an assembly point, so to say, at another place, making another position of consciousness possible, and also have another way of interacting with the world, and which has in many cases to do with spirituality and meaning, impossible. So I find this a nice way of putting the things.
I completely agree. That seems to be the big problem with contemporary directions of mysticism and parapsychology, as you've said, yeah. is this intolerance and the scientism as the default position of all investigation.
Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. Thanks. That was great. Thanks very much for coming on.
Okay, it was very nice to be your guest, and I wish you have much more interviews.